So good morning, everyone. Today I'm going to talk about quantitative trait locus, or most commonly known as QTL. I think that's the first one when you actually heard about genetics and, you know, plants, agriculture, breeding program. The first thing you're going to heard about is quantitative trait locus, which is sort of, which is the full name for QTL, and it's pronounced stuff, which is why it's something I never understand until I actually start making this video. Okay, so just go for the very general definition first. So QTL is a specific chromosomal region of genetic or genetic locus in which particular sequence of bases in DNA markers are statistically associated with the variation in trait. So I'm not going to explain this, it's too complicated to for everyone, anyone to actually understand. So the question I want to ask here is that actually how scientists knows that a gene which is responsible for, let's say, a production of melatonin, which is the pigment under your skin, is located at that genetic location. You know, how would they know? It's in chromosome 6, 75% to the half or something like that. So most of the gene we now have in human are actually done through a procedure called QTL mapping, where they try to, where, you know, they know that gene that do that thing belongs to that location. So that is a very, very complicated process. Remember, this is done maybe 20, 30 years ago without the tool for next generation sequencing. So with next generation sequencing, of course, you can just sequence everything at once. But without that, QTL actually helps a lot to identify specific location of gene, locations, multiple location that is directly related to a single traits here on the genome and the plants. Okay, so I'm just going to go through how actually scientists identify a single genetic location. First of all, it's identify a trait that you want to study. This could be the color of the plants, the biomass of the plants, is like how big they are. Is it a bigger watermelon or a smaller watermelon? How fast do they grow? So do you want a faster growing version or a slower growing version? And why would you choose each of them? Things like that. So a trait that you want to study. Trait here. So a trait refers to a phenotype, something you can observe on. Okay, then you get another species or a different species, depends on the situation they're in, and you try to crossbreed them here. So remember, one of them is half the trait and one without. And you try to get a breeding. So you get a children here, which has statistically or normally you get about half-half, okay? 50% from the mom, 50% from the dad. But remember here, we are talking about plants. We're not really talking about human. It's not really an ethical decision to do if you are breeding human in your lab. It has been done, but not anymore. Okay, so in this case, the F1 hybrid here, remember hybrid can refer to offspring from two species or just two particular parents with different traits. Okay, so this is the F1 hybrid, generation 1 hybrid. I don't know why they call it F1. Maybe they like racing car or whatever. Okay, so the first generation doesn't have a lot of use because we can't study them because they are so homogeneous in their whole genetic makeup. So we try to make them with itself. Of course, for plants, you can put a pollen and then put back to the ovum of the same plant, or you can try to do it to the siblings. Again, that's why I say it's not really a good thing to do it on human being. Okay, then you get that this is called the F2 hybrid, which is the second generation hybrid of the parents, okay? First generation, second generation hybrid. So in second generation hybrid, we start to have a lot of varieties. We start to have children with both, which express the father gene and the mother gene simultaneously, but not at equal weightage or equal density, okay? So this guy obviously has more of the mother gene. This guy obviously has more of the father gene, and this guy is a bit weird because of some mutation or genetic recombination problem, things like that. Okay, so from this F2 hybrid, then we can start to observe the color. So in this case, if we want, let's say we want this one, we want the mom features with that face outside of it. So this is the feature that we want to study on. Okay, so you identify this is the one with the most amount of feature, and this is the one with the least amount of feature that we're going to study. So this is the one we want, this is the one we don't want. Okay, so with that, then we can try to study the DNA marker. So DNA marker can be and SMP or AFLP. So this can be studied through microarray, where you take the gene, break it up, and try to put it on a microchip. So you can study a lot of SMP simultaneously. It might be the home genome, it might not, it depends. It might be just on a single chromosome, which is roughly what I've showed here. So in this case, the amount of SMP present, amount of SMP present will be high, means that the threat will be high. So if both of them are high, you get a high score here. So if you get a high threat, low SMP, you get a low score. So I should just actually explain the axis first. So the first one is called a correlation index, or we commonly know as LOD, is a log of odds. So the higher index here means that they are very, very correlated. So the higher expression of SMP means a very strong threat. Okay, so you detect a lot of SMP in that region. There's a very strong purple color phase, purple color this round thing outside of it, you get a high score. Okay, so if you don't, but if you get a high expression of SMP, but with the opposite trait, then you get a low score. So we know that this region, if it's highly densely populated with SMP, this is the region that is most likely responsible for the production of the purple color over here. Okay, so this is the region of interest. So on a horizontal axis over here is the location of chromosome. So just look at here. Okay, this is the region that I want to find. So you map back to the chromosome. So a chromosome looks somewhat like this with the chiasmata in the middle. Okay, then you know this is very, very near to the centromere. So this region of chromosome is the region of interest. This is the part that we want to study. So you know that the thread responsible for the gene locates responsible for certain threads is located at this locus which we can measure in a quantitative way, which is why the whole thing is called quantitative trait locus QTL. Okay, so that's another thing. What happens after we actually find the location? So if you know SMP markers, when we actually try to target it, we don't actually sequence the gene out. They are pre-sequenced, and I will talk about genetic sequencing in another video. But in this case, once you find the usefulness, you can try to target two PCR primers, opposite side of it, and try to fish the whole genetic code out. Okay, so this is part of the genetic sequencing before NGS. Okay, so you have to design a small primer in a run the back, sequence it, and then try to match it back after you've done a lot of Sanger. Or you might need to do a yeast mutant, you might need to do bacterial artificial chromosome, depends on the size. So a small size, easy, but a big size, usually very, very problematic. And I believe my supervisor did her whole master's program just to sequence that one gene. And that was not that far ago, that was like 10 or 15 years ago. Okay, so once you identify the sequence, then it's a lot easier. Then we can design tag that you can actually check the expression on that directly using fish, maybe. Fish is fluorescent, easy to hybridization. Or you can design like a microRNA primer that just immediately, you know, silence the gene directly on site. This can be done through microRNA or TI plasmid or some other bacteria factors in that case. So the whole process that we're trying to say here is actually how QTL mapping works and what is a QTL. So QTL is a locus. It's a location on a gene which is particularly linked to a certain traits which we have measured quantitatively. So quantitative trait locus. Okay, and mapping is trying to map the trait and the genetic locus together. So the formal definition of QTL mapping is a method utilized to define the general chromosomal position of the gene or gene variants that influence the magnitude of a measurable trait. So if you have a higher expression of a gene from this location, most likely they have a purple phase. And if you have a low genetic expression on this level, most likely is not relevant in any way. Remember, this is not expression, this is LOD. Okay, so that's quantitative trait locus, QTL, or okay, so I hope you learned something. This helicase, happy unwinding.